One of my favorite books, and one of the books that I probably have taught the most on, the Book of Ephesians. This book is rich, and so much for us to learn how we are to walk and live and what God has called us to do. The title of this message really is, How Does God See Us? How does God see you? How does God see you? How does God see us? I doubt very seriously most of us ever think about it. We think about all kinds of things, and maybe we think about how other people see us and this, that, and the other. But most of us don't think about how does God Almighty see us on a daily, constant basis. And we're going to look at some of that today that will be kind of breathtaking and absolutely freeing and wonderful as we get some kind of insight into it. Let's jump into it. Paul was very much aware he's in prison. He's waiting. He knows he's going to be killed. No, he's going to be martyred. He's literally waiting on it. He knows that's about to happen. So he was aware that his trial, the trial that he was waiting on, that it's going to result in his life being given for the kingdom of Almighty God. And before that happened, though, he wanted and was determined that he wanted to share at the church at Ephesus the most important things that he had learned. So in his letter, Paul outlines the 10 spiritual blessings that God has given us, and then taught us how to walk them out, and at the end of the letter, how to protect those blessings with the full armor of God. So that's what you can, in a little nutshell, what you can find there in Ephesians. In light of that, let's go what we will address this morning, Ephesians 1, 1 through 6. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful to Christ Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. Now, I'm going to flip back real quick and let's go reread Ephesians 1, 1 through 2. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, notice right off the bat, that's what it said. It says that Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. It was important to Paul that the Ephesians knew that he was an apostle, not because somebody appointed him, not because he graduated from some seminary, not because somebody went out trying to hire him and put somebody in charge of the church or whatever. It wasn't because of some academic program that, you know, that he had been a part of, nor was he self-appointed. And he wanted to make it very clear that Paul did not decide to become an apostle. Now, I want to tell you right up front before we get very far along, I've met many self-proclaimed apostles and prophets. I've met self-proclaimed preachers and pastors, people who just saw it as a job and they just applied for it and got it and whatever. But I'm here to tell you that is not the way God does things. So Paul didn't decide to become an apostle. He was an apostle by a calling from God. a calling. It was the will of God that Paul become an apostle. He did not choose it. He did not go after it. It was appointed unto him. He was called. It was his calling to do this. Knowing your calling is vitally important. Now, I want everybody in here to hear me today, because every person here has a calling. Amen. There's not anyone here without a calling from God Almighty. And I'm going to help you find it today so that you can walk in it and be who God has told you to be. It's essential that you settle in your mind that the will of God called you to right where he put you. Even to be in a church has a calling to it, that God would call you to be a part of a fellowship. So if you don't settle that God called you and God put you even where you are now, and you think you just wander around, just do your own thing, and you just live outside of the will of God, no, you are here by calling. So we all have the primary callings. I'm giving you your primary calling. So everybody has a primary calling, or your utmost calling, or your main calling, or the key calling. Everybody has it to be transformed into the image and the likeness of Jesus. That is your calling. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you do. I don't care. Your calling, wherever it may take you, this is your primary calling, and it's to be transformed into the image and the likeness of Jesus. So whatever specific calling that God has on your life, in addition to the path of life by which you demonstrate Jesus here on the earth. So let me put it this way. God has graced you for your calling. He's going to lead you and guide you in it, and he's going to work out the issues that you're going to face in living out that calling. Number one calling, the primary calling. Remember, whatever your job may be is not your primary calling. Your calling, and it's for everybody. Your calling, again, is to be transformed into the image and likeness of Jesus. That's what you are to be doing, wherever you are. Preaching and teaching for Paul was never a job. Paul was not a hireling. He knew he was called by God. Now, who was Paul writing to? It says, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus. The word saint simply means one set apart for God. So Paul rightly identifies the recipients of his letter, and they weren't the Ephesians or the Greeks. They were the saints. He was writing to the saints, just like your saints. I'm talking to saints this morning. His greeting to them was, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, you may be filled with the unmerited favor of God and with the kind of peace that weathers any storm with quiet confidence. After the opening greeting, Paul gets down to the business of the letter, and it is glorious. Are y'all buckled up? Are you ready to go? The key verse to the entire book is verse 3, to the entire book. If you hadn't underlined it, I suggest you do, because it's the cornerstone of this entire letter to the Ephesians. Let's look at it, verse 3 and 4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. That's verse 3. That is the key verse for the entire book of Ephesians. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now, you and I have been given every spiritual blessing that exists. Amen. Nothing has been held back. Right. Every spiritual blessing. Your Father, your Heavenly Father, has given to you every spiritual blessing. Not some, not a few, every single one of them. He's given them to you. Every blessing. And to understand that, you need to remember that the old covenant, that the old covenant God, that the covenant made by God with Israel, was predominantly a physical or earthly covenant. Now you need to hear this, because this is where some people get confused. God promised to give them the land of Israel if they were obedient to Him. He promised to give them children, to multiply their crops and their livestock, and He promised to heal all their diseases. But everything in the Old Testament, all the promises were earthly. They were not spiritual. Now, so in other words, the old covenant was displayed in earthly terms when Israel walked in obedience to God. For instance, the verse we like to quote all the time, Exodus 15:26. If you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in His sight, give ear to His commandments and keep all His statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. We all know that last one, I am the Lord who heals you. But you got to remember, in this is a verse that points out that everything in the Old Testament, all the promises were earthly. Are you listening to me? Yeah. So healing in the Old Testament, for example, was related to obedience to the Torah. God healed if you will. Are you following me? If you will, it says, then healing came with it. There is a distinct shift in the New Covenant. The focus goes beyond physical healing in the New Covenant. In the new covenant of grace, spiritual healing becomes a prominent theme. Now, it doesn't mean that God is not still doing physical healing, but you need to listen to me. Spiritual healing is the prominent theme in the New Testament. Where you are spiritually is what matters to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because all of the blessings are spiritual blessings that are given to us. Look at 3 John 1:2. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. That verse should be a prominent verse when it comes to healing. And a lot of people, matter of fact, a lot of folks have tried to even rewrite that verse so that it doesn't really say what it really says. You look at some of the other translations, they will kind of move it around, and yet this is exactly what it says and what it means. I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health. In other words, you can prosper and you can be in health if your soul is prospering. Mind, will, and emotions. That's your soul, your mind, your will, and emotions. And if they are prospering, meaning if you're growing in the things of the Lord, then automatically, physically, things will begin to happen in your body, good things, related to the degree that your soul prospers. Spiritual blessings in the writing of Ephesians and in all that Paul did, spiritual blessings is what Paul is totally concerned with. Amen. God is looking for people who will get excited about their spiritual blessings because they last forever. Amen. Earthly blessings don't. In other words, you can't take that Lexus to heaven. But your spiritual blessings are yours forever. Matter of fact, your spiritual blessings that you blossom in down here could move you to a higher level in heaven. Yes.
From the beginning of time, God orchestrated a way for you and I to be free from sin and sickness. Because of Jesus, we have victory over any type of illness. In these three teachings, learn what is available to you and how to live free from sickness. We're also including a fourth CD of a message in which Sandra teaches how to handle offenses, which can lead to a destructive life. Your response to an offense will ultimately determine your destiny. Place your order today by calling or visit our website.
So what then are these blessings that God has given us? 10 of them in chapter 1 of Ephesians. We're going to do 5 of them this morning. We hadn't got to them yet in case y'all didn't know. All right. Verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. The first thing that we learn is that all these blessings are in heavenly places.
Amen.
It's amazing how many people have made Ephesians chapter 1, made them physical. They're spiritual blessings that can show themselves in the physical world after you have grown spiritually. Verse 4. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Do you realize that before God created the world, before he created Adam and Eve, before Noah's flood showed up, and before we ever heard of Abraham's faith, before Moses received the Torah on Mount Sinai, before Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and all the prophets ever heard one thing from God, before every bit of that, your Heavenly Father knew you. Now stay with me. Stay with me because I want you to get this. He knew your name. He saw you. He determined when in history you would be on this earth. Before anything was on the earth. He gave you a destiny. Not only did he love you, me, loved me, he knew every sin that I would ever commit. He knew every sin you'd ever commit before you ever did it. He loved you anyway. But not only did he love you, he chose you. So, blessing number one, God chose you. And what did he choose you for? To be holy and without blame before him. Blessing number two. He made you holy and blameless.
Thank you.
You know, people can blame you for all kinds of things, but when God chose you, church, he determined that you would be blameless.
Amen.
You have to understand, this is God the Father
Yes.
who is making you and forming you and fashioning you. It's your Father
Yes.
who's doing this. And the blessings, if you pay attention to them, if they were not true for you, you couldn't go back to him.
Amen.
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 The Father decided he would not post your mistakes, your failures, or sins to your account because of the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's a shout. He's already said he knows them. He just let the blood remove them. Should be some shouting around here. Guilt is gone, shame is gone, embarrassment is gone.
Yes.
If you're a disciple of the Lord Jesus, dedicated wholly to Him, you're chosen, you're holy, and you're blameless.
Yes.
It's time you could shout again if you felt like it. God also knew ahead of time those who would choose Him and those who wouldn't. But that didn't stop Him from giving everyone an opportunity.
Yes. Yes.
Because see, every person has to make a choice. Every person who's ever been born has made a choice. Unless it was a baby or somebody that automatically just went back to the Lord because of the Lord's grace and mercy. Let's look at John 3:16. I think you know it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Choice. Choice. Now let's look at verse 5 of Ephesians. Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to Himself according to the good pleasure of His will. Now don't let that word predestined throw you. Let's say it this way. Because God knows all things, He knew ahead of time that you would choose Him, talking about us, those who've chosen, that you would choose Him, and therefore He predetermined what would happen in your life that was good. Because only good comes from God.
Amen.
So, to predetermine also means to limit in advance. Grab hold of this one. Your Heavenly Father saw everything that would come in your life, and because He knew you thoroughly and He knew what you could handle, He set a limit on what the devil would try to do to derail you, deceive you, and destroy you. In other words, we could say it this way. This is a big shout coming. You could say it this way. Jesus drew a line in the sand and said to the devil, this far and no further.
Yes.
Glory to God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Woo. Yes. Glory to God.
Yes.
Now, then of course you want to say, well, how come all this stuff in my life? Well, I'm going to tell you.
Okay.
He could not set a limit to your fleshly choices.
Right.
That's a matter of free will. And God will never violate your free will. In other words, you got an issue here. What the devil can do, and Jesus has limited what the devil can do in your life, but the flesh is another issue.
Amen.
And the flesh is your choice. So I could put it this way. God limited your drama before your drama got you. Lesson number 3, He predestined or predetermined that you would become like Jesus.
Hallelujah.
In that same verse 5, it says that He also adopted us in the verse that we read. Now, adoption is a process by which a person who is not part of a family is brought into the family with all legal rights and privileges of that family. So Moses became the prince of Egypt because he was adopted by Pharaoh's daughter, though he'd been born to Hebrew slaves. Esther was adopted by a godly uncle, and she was not any kind of royal lineage, but she became a queen. Yes. Joseph adopted Jesus and functioned as an earthly father. Yes. Now, under the old covenant, we Gentiles were not part of God's family.
That's right.
God chose Israel as his family. But when Jesus came and shed his blood for the whole world, the Father adopted us then into his family. Look at in verse 5, it says, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself. Every promise made to the children of Israel is now ours. Yes. As well, because the Father adopted us.
Yes.
Promises like, you're the head and you're not the tail.
Amen.
I'll take you as my people. I will live in the midst of you. You're a special treasure unto me. I will deliver you from bondage. I will take sickness out of your midst. I will be an enemy to your enemies. I will put my spirit within you. I will bless you when you bless Israel, and so many more. All because the Father adopted you. Blessing number 4, he adopted us. Verse 6. To the praise of the glory of his grace by which he made us accepted in the beloved. The word translated accepted in the Greek literally means highly favored, worthy of special honor. That's kind of, profound, because favor isn't fair. I accept favor, hallelujah. Favor will take you places, will open doors, make provisions, and do things you don't deserve. And God will do it because you are highly favored. You are accepted. God's acceptance is so complete that he literally loves you as much as he loves Jesus. Look at John 17. I in them and you and me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me, and I have loved them as you have loved me.
Amen.
Blessing number 5. God accepts you.
Yeah.
Well, we've gone through 5 blessings.
Thank you.
Yes.
We've been chosen, made holy and blameless,
yes.
Predetermined,
yes.
Adopted,
yes.
And accepted.
Yes.
So we'll pick up from here next Sunday. And see what else your Father has done for you so that you can come back to him looking like Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Glory to God. Glory to God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. God loves you so much.